heaven. He's got places that he wants us to go. He's given us a kingdom. He's given us a kingdom of resources. Hallelujah. I want to be a pioneer. I want to go into those places and bring people behind me as we go in and pioneer into new places that he would have us to go. I believe that even as long as the word has been written and where we are, there's still places that the church has not gone yet. There's still unmarked territory. And I don't know about you, but I want to go. Hallelujah. So God, help us this morning, Lord, not to be settlers. Hallelujah. We can already sing a song. It's about a miracle working God, how he opened eyes, how he turned water into wine, how he had the darkness. Hallelujah. We shine. How ashes that we rise. Hallelujah, Lord. I don't want to be a settler, Lord. Hallelujah. I want to be a pioneer for the kingdom. Stand with me this morning. If you want to come, hallelujah, and take territory in the name of Jesus. There are people waiting for us in the darkness. There are people waiting for us to shine this morning.
truth, oh God. Hallelujah. And you set people free, Lord, today, God. Hallelujah, Lord. We present those requests now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We come in agreement, oh God, with what Nathan the Saunders, oh God, praying, oh God. God, in the needs, oh God, that we carry on our hearts, oh God. God, people who need help, oh God, in relationships, oh God. People who need setting free, God, from addictions, oh God. God, people who need help, oh God, in their bank accounts, oh Lord. God, we bring this before you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. You're more than Santa Claus, oh God. And God, you're an awesome God. Hallelujah. Who is standing the test of time. Who created this world. Hallelujah. Who put it into being. And you put purpose and destiny in me, Lord. Hallelujah. That you're ready for me to unlock. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you, God. We honor you, Lord, this morning, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Our God is greater this morning.
Our God is greater.
Faithful. sing with me, "How great is our God," and all will see how great, how great, how great is our God. How great is our God.
Is our God. Oh, how great. Thank you.
We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this time together this morning. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
The Lord, but in our worship, that's how relaxed we should be. Sometimes it just seems so tight in here, and it's, you know, we just need to breathe deep and relax, right, and just worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Tonight we have a special service with Abner Suarez. He is the founder for such a time as this ministries. He'll have some resources and some books for sale. He is an author and a pretty much a world traveler as far as a speaker. So I'd like for you guys to come back and bring two or three friends. I'd like to have a real good service tonight. He's got a very I'd say heavy prophetic anointing upon him, and I believe will be operating in that gift tonight. So please be in prayer for tonight's service. Well, it's really good to see all of you guys. I'm probably embarrassed just one or two people here, and I normally don't do this, but they've traveled a long ways. Nick's mom and dad are here, Richard and Doris, and it's, we're really happy to see you guys. So, and we have some other visitors as well, and thank you for being here, and we just want you to feel welcome, feel at home. Just a couple of announcements. Whoever wants to get up real early next Sunday, we know today is what? Palm Sunday, and we're not speaking on that, but we know that this week, running into next week, is a very significant time for Christendom. This is a high note. This is one of the things that we rest our belief and our testimony that he is no longer dead, amen, that he is risen, right? And that's what we proclaim, that's what we herald today. And but whoever wants to get up real early next Sunday morning, 6:15, we'll have a sunrise service at Center Hill Baptist Church. And of those who would like to participate on Friday afternoon, they're going to do a crosswalk. They're going to gather at the new courthouse in Eaton. You can get a big cross or a small cross, but they will do a crosswalk and go from the new courthouse to the old courthouse, walk down Main Street, take Water Street, and then end up with a time of prayer together. As I was studying about today, what I would share, I've done probably a lot more pondering and just thinking through things. But one of the verses that that came to me as I was studying, it's in Isaiah. It's first recorded in the Bible in Isaiah. This is not the text reference, but it says, "My house will be called a house of prayer for all people." And that's what I want to talk about today, is whether it's home improvements or house improvements. But we gather here on Monday evenings to help make this a house of prayer. And that's one of the really cool things. We're interceding for people in circumstances, and they don't even know that we're doing it, right? And as we were just worshiping a few minutes ago, I just thought the need to maybe rehearse. In the Old Testament, it speaks about the priest had a breastplate and had the each tribe was represented on the breastplate. And you and I, we are priests. In 2017, we are anointed as priests. So I'm asked for you to think of 12 things, 12 circumstances, world circumstances, or maybe it's a multitude of things. Maybe it's a few people, six people, and six world situation or family situation. But remember that we have the ability and the privilege to go to the throne and deliver things to the throne room, because that's what a priest did. A priest went to the holy place. This is not in the notes, I'm sorry, but we have the opportunity to walk into a holy place because of our kingly and priestly anointing, and we're carrying things to the Lord that other people just don't know how to get there. And I'm not trying to be mean, but we have that responsibility on us. So I want to, as I connect with you guys and go across the room, 12 things or 12 people. We have the ability. You have family and friends and the world situation. I don't know who knows that Jeremy was telling me this morning that two churches in Egypt was bombed. And so we need intercessors. The kingdom of God needs intercessors. So we'll move on with the notes. Immediately after service, we'll have sign-ups for home groups. We're going to kick off home groups the week of Easter. Again, thank you for being here. Please turn over to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, as we talk about home improvements or house improvements, ever how that your intricacies of defining those words. Maria, a little bit of same scripture we ended with last week, towards the end of the chapter. But this is Acts chapter 2. It's we Pentecostals or the ones from the charismatic side of Christendom. Celebrate. This is a chapter of celebration, and it's the chapter one starts out with the disciples, the believers in Christ. They were gathered in the upper room because Christ says, "Tarry there until you receive the promise of the Father." And in Acts chapter 2, the first part of it, we know the storyline. Most of us know the story where the Holy Spirit fell upon them. They were speaking in other tongues. Some thought they were drunk folks. And Peter, we get ready to catch the ending of what the aftermath of wake of Peter's sermon. And he spoke about these people aren't drunk like you think they are. It's kind of early in the day to be drunk. But he said that this is what Joel spoke about. And so he goes and shares his sermon. And come to find out 3,000, we'll read that in a moment, but 3,000 come to the Lord. And that's kind of where we're picking up. So I'm going to read 37 through 47. Acts 2, 37 through 47. House improvements or home improvements. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart. That's the people who had heard Peter's sermon I was trying to share earlier. And said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brethren, what shall we do?" Peter said, "Repent. And each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all." Let's say all together. All. Talking about the promise of the Father. "It's for your children and all who are far off, as many as the Lord your God will call to himself." And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, "Be saved from the perverse generation." So then those who had received his words were baptized. And that day there were added about 3,000 souls. And they continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to the prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe. I'm a pause there. This is not in my ponderings and in my thought processes this week. I didn't write this down. But I'm going to speak about the things of the early church. Maybe a little comparison about now, first century church and now. The early church was in a sense of awe at the presence and the moving of the Lord. There was miracles and signs and wonders. I believe that's going to happen. It may happen in this service, but I believe it certainly is going to happen tonight, in tonight's service. But it was a sense of awe that swept across everyone. It says, again, everyone kept feeling a sense of awe. And many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property. Relax when I read that. Relax. They began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as one might have need. And day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking the bread from house to house, they were taking meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. So, Father, we, as we've just read a few verses of your word, we ask that you would just come and that you would open our hearts, that my words would be well-defined and I would speak with clarity and with understanding. So, God, give us ears that can receive, hearts that are soft. In Jesus' name, amen. So last week, I think the first couple of comments that I made, that for the last Sunday and this Sunday, we'd be talking about the early church. And what were we to be talking about? Why were we talking about the early church? And I think there's two main reasons I mentioned. All right, so one was that I believe that the early church is our pattern. Not just for, you know, H Square or Happy Home or where you're sitting at right here. I believe that's for all the churches. The early church is a pattern for us to look at. And maybe I would say to follow after, not mimic, but to follow after. And number two is that I believe they must have done something right, because we're still talking about Jesus Christ. We're still talking about his teaching, right? We're still talking about the Acts of the Apostles. So the message of a couple thousand years ago, the men and women must have done something right, right? Because we still have the message today. We're still, think about all the people that will be in worship from Palm Sunday today. This is a significant Sunday, even though that's not our sermon today. But think about worldwide, about this Sunday and next Sunday, all the worshipers of Jesus Christ. Our Lord and Savior, right? And just think about who we participate with. The number of people. They did something right. Absolutely. And that's what I wanted to talk about just a little bit today. As I was studying, and I've already said pondering, I use that word probably more than maybe I should, but I was just thinking about if somebody was to asked me, that didn't know much about the early church, what are some words that I would use to describe the early church? And my vocabulary words, what would they be, as I shared about these men and these women of faith, and our followers of the faith, right? Significant people to us. The first few people that this was called to follow after this man. And they had not really a clue of who he was when he said, "Hey, come follow me. I'm going to make you fishers of men," right? And how did they even connect with that? They didn't even know what a fisher of a man was, right? But they connected, and by faith they followed after wherever he was at. And so what's some things that I would try to describe? I thought about united. I believe the worshipers and the followers and the disciples, which is a key word. I mean, I was reading something from Barna here recently, and they were talking about the ones who love Jesus but don't love the church, which I think that's almost unbiblical. Because Christ is coming back for his church, right? So why should we love the church? And so there's some people that may have lost their way, but speaking of the early church, I said united, on fire, connected. They were praying people, disciple-making people. That was one of their first job descriptions, you know, to go and to make disciples. I believe they were focused. There's many words that I could say, and some other words that probably just popped into your mind as we started talking about the early church. And then I started thinking about a leapfrog to where I stand at or live at in 2017. If somebody asked me to describe the American church, not talking about the church of Zimbabwe, Pakistan, or you know the hidden church there, or maybe Latin America, a place there. How would I describe the American church? Would I use some of the same vocabulary, or would I choose different words? I'm just going to leave a blank right there and let you fill in the blanks. But I will say that whatever it looks like in our city, and I'm not just talking about, you know, under this roof, I'm talking about in our area, please understand that there is revival sparking across our nation. There's a revival sparking on the East Coast, there's revival sparking in Texas and Oklahoma, over on the, some folks tease and say on the left coast, but you know, on California and Washington, no matter what you think it looks like, the gospel is on the move. Amen. The kingdom of God is growing. Amen. For the first time in history, if we took Africa and we brought that together with, as far as numerically, with Latin America, those two places, 1 billion Christians. 1 billion. Amen. Now, what's our head count right now? Some over 7 billion. So that's a big number. The kingdom is on an exponential growth of people coming in to the kingdom. And our story here is 3,000, right? That's the birthing of the church. And I continue to think about the many different adjectives that maybe I've used or we've heard or can come about through our lips, adjectives with the church. We talked about the early church, and I think we've heard about the modern church, or the postmodern church, the hard ones and the soft ones, the denominational church, the purpose-driven church, the Laodicean church, the sticky church. Now, some of these are books that people have written about. What about a mega church, or the transformational church, the Western church, the New Testament church, the Enlightened church, this church, that church? We've heard my church, right? Maybe we've used that. But even in my thoughts and as I considered all this and thinking about the New Testament and the early church and the church of today that I'm a part of, I realized that, you know, there's certain preferences that Walter likes. You know, if I was to draw it out, you know, this is the way things should be, right? I've got preferences from my perspective. And you know what? You do too. You've got, if you was to draw it up the way the church should be according to whoever you are, right? But let's understand that in our preferences, that's all that is. God has wired us some to love a hymn, and some is going to love Southern gospel, and we would sing it all the time, and some would say, no, I want it, sing a rock and roll for Jesus song, you know? And that's just the way we're wired. It's okay. But understand that that's all it is, because all of a sudden, in the way we prefer, the church size we would choose to go to, if we had all these choices, think about if all of a sudden you were plucked up and planted over, let's say, China, into a small house church. And we just sang, "How great is our God? Sing with me," yes, right? Yes. Now some was singing hard, and some maybe was singing not so much, right? And I'm not casting stones, I'm just, whoever wanted to sing was free to sing. And you could belt it out, or you could have kept your mouth shut, right? But there's circumstances in our globe that you don't have the privilege to sing out loud. So, but if you found yourself there, I do believe, even though you prefer to sing out and pray, sing praise unto God, you would probably elect to keep your tone down, to preserve your life, right? So, in those thoughts of our preferences, hey, let's not make a sacred cow out of it, or let's not, let's realize we can't make a doctrine out of it. It's our preference, and it's okay to have preferences. God wired us that way. And then as I was thinking through the church and the adjectives and that sort of thing, I began to think about, what about the ideal church? Or maybe the perfect church? And I was thinking, where did that even come from? Where did the perfect church even come from? You know, that thought. So I was thinking, well, if everyone everywhere that has this thought, you know, of the perfect church, and they all showed up, you know, on the same Sunday at this place, it still wouldn't be perfect, right? Because they would have people there, and you know that we're imperfect. So I guess I boiled it down to as considering where our church is, the American church, my considerations there, that maybe the most important adjective is it a biblical church? And so that's what I want to kind of go back and hit a couple verses here about the biblical church, the biblical early church and the things that they were doing. We read this, the last verse we read last week, and I want to go to chapter 2, verse 42. And I want to read out two or three, I want to read about four different translations, same verse, to try to convey the verse. I'm not going into the Greek on a couple words here. I certainly could, but I think these verses and the breakdown of it will convey to us what the early church, the ladies and the guys, were about in verse 42. Because there's four activities, I'll call them activities here that are listed, which they took part in. And many of the scriptures that we read will find one or two of them. But in this verse, it's brought out that they were doing all four of them. And Don Caskey shared with us a couple of years ago, or maybe a little longer than that, he called them the four pillars of the church. And see if you can pick them out. This is out of the Living Bible. They, meaning the followers of Christ, the disciples and all who were following after Christ, they joined with the other believers in regular attendance at the apostles' teaching, the sessions, at the communion services, and the prayer meetings. That was the Living Bible. In the Message Bible, in 42, it says this: they committed themselves to the teaching of the apostles, life together, the common meal, and the prayers. Now, some of the translations will read prayers, and some of them will read the prayers. Some believe that where the is written, that it was actually, they were participating in the time of the synagogue prayer, praying unto the Lord, but they were still, it was certain the prayers, because it was at a certain time of the day. In the Amplified Bible, it reads like this: and they were continually and faithfully devoting themselves to the instructions of the apostles, to the fellowship, to the eating of meals, and to prayers. The New Living Translation reads like this: all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, and the sharing of meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. So what can we glean from this? And where I'm at is, you know, the steadfastness of the continuation, the the commitment, the word, some translations are using devoted. And I asked last Sunday, that's the last question I asked, I think, and I asked, what are you devoted to? The early church, it says that here, they were devoted to four things. So what can we glean from this? What's contending for your time? What's jockeying for position in your life? It's clear that what the apostles and the followers of Christ were doing, it's very clear. It's listed for us here. And I know, look, the apostles and the followers of Christ, I mean, if we back up in time, they didn't have this. They didn't have a cell phone. They didn't have all the opportunity. I got a couple of smiles when, you know, looking at this. Except, I guess you were reading your Bible on it, right? But they didn't have these things. They didn't have a car that would go 35, 45, 55, 65, 75, 85. They didn't have cars. They couldn't travel, really. Right? They walked, or maybe in our day as we celebrate Palm Sunday, you know, they would ride animals. So what's jockeying for your time? And again, I go back to my question of last week, what are you devoted to? And you can ask me the same thing. I think we should consider that. They were committed, continually and faithfully devoting themselves to these four things. These four things are still available to be devoted to. And you may be saying, there's just so much more to do. And I understand that. We were talking about spinning plates and our responsibilities in journey class today. Acts 6 reads like this, 6, 4, and 7. It says, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. And the Word of God, because I think this is what we're after. If we as Christians, if we're not after this, then we better go somewhere and get things straight. So let me finish the what I think the goal is. It said, the word of God kept spreading, and the number of disciples continued to increase greatly. That, you and I as a Christian, that should be one of our desires, to see the word of God spread abroad. And the reason why this verse is true is because verse 42 in chapter 2 is true. That they were devoting themselves to things that would usher in and to propel the spreading of God's word, the kingdom. Acts 5:42 says this, and every day in the temple. Now, we don't call this a temple, right? But it's a place of worship. And what this means is, in the outer court, the people would go and hear the teachings of the apostles. And the hear and see the miracles of what was going on in that day and when Christ was walking the earth. And it says that every day in the temple and from house to house. So let me go back to a verse I read, and I said that, hey, relax. We're not going to ask everybody to sell their house, right? But they were connected with one another. They continued with one another. They had life together, and as there was need, we read that verse, as there was need, the people got together and they met the need. Now, if everybody, this is not some kind of sect and we're going to, hey, let's throw all our money in one pile and we're going to have a commune and we're going to live together. That's not even what this says. They said they sold some property, yes, to meet some needs, yes. But if everybody sold their house, how could they go house to house? Right? So let's get at, that's bad thinking if that's what we think the apostles did, sell everything they had. So back to home improvements. I believe the church that we participate in is a beautiful thing. It's beautiful. Now, is there some issues? Sure, there's some issues. Sure, it's okay. We have issues. Most churches have issues. Our area, I wish there wasn't any poverty in our area. I wish everybody wasn't living below a certain standard, but we have issues in our communities that need to be met, and the church needs to be helping to meet the need in the community. But still, I mentioned some of the beautiful things. I know not just us, but we come together on Monday night and interceding for other people. That's a beautiful thing. And I know other churches are doing that as well. I think it's a beautiful thing when a church comes together, a small church like Happy Home, and we raise about, I don't know where the number's at. Yeah, have you got a total on where we're at? Patrick, I'll put you on the spot. Okay, so you peoples, you beautiful peoples, and if it's another 500 don't come in, the church will throw in another 500. But you peoples, we're going to call it $10,000. We've raised $10,000.
Yes.
Come on, we've raised $10,000 to reach a people in a country you will never see these people, and you'll probably never go to Ukraine. Right? You've raised $10,000. You need to give a shout out. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. So there's some beautiful things that are taking place in our community. Right now, Jeremy, we've been communicating, Chris and Jeremy and I. Johnny spoke about the youth pastor over at Rocky Hop, and it, please continue to pray for that family, please. But they're right now, they're trying to, this is not, I can announce this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So another youth pastor at another church is saying, hey, let's do something to raise money for the Denny family. So they're putting together a kickball tournament to raise funds for another youth pastor. And there'll be several area churches that are participating. That's a beautiful thing taking place.
Yes.
That's beautiful. That's the way things ought to be because we're on the same team. Yes. We're under the same umbrella that says Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. And it's a blood-stained banner. Glory to God. Right? That's a beautiful thing. But as I was thinking certainly there's room for improvements. Home and house improvements. And this came to me, I believe, last night. I didn't know how I was going to close my comments down here because I was wanting to just share about the early church and how they went house to house, and we're getting ready to kick off our home groups and that sort of thing. I thought this would be the right way to do it. But this came to me actually last night, and I just started thinking about what God was doing in the natural was also taking place in the spiritual setting. And I started thinking about Johnny Dale, Patrick Morris. These guys are home improvement specialists. They are contractors. And it might be somebody else. That I know we have some fencing and some security people in the room. And so there's people that will help you improve your home or your house setting in the natural. And I believe we've got that in the spiritual sense as well. And in this house, in this property right here, in the last 6 months, We've had some house improvements, right? And praise God, if y'all haven't been to the nursery, I know some of y'all have been to the bathroom, but our nursery has been updated in the last, you know, 3 or 4 months. We've got new bathrooms and a facelift in the ladies' bathroom, and there's home or house improvements that's taking place. And then I started thinking about in the natural, we've got people in the natural that's improving their house, at their house. I thought about Johnny and Dick. They're doing a kitchen makeover or whatever you want to call it. I thought about James and Beth. They've recently done some kicking out of a wall and some improvements. And praise God, your house improved too with a little baby named Sage this week too, right? So that's an improvement. As well as Robin and I are making some changes as well. I'm just curious, is anybody else that's doing any, in the last 6 months, done any house improvements? Harry and Teresa? Yep. Okay. So, in the natural, our homes are being improved. Yes. Our homes are being improved. And we're kicking off the week of Easter. It'll be for 8 weeks. We're going to do home groups, and we've got them. I'm releasing you in just a moment or two to sign up. And those homes, Jonathan and Leah's home, and brother and Gwen, Ricky and Denise, and I'll say Tori and Nick's home. That's improving those houses as well. Because they're opening their houses up to affect the community. And one of the verses that spoke or came to me was, as you visit, deposit peace. So they've opened their houses up, yeah, for a certain purpose, but I believe that not only are they blessing people, but their homes will be blessed because peace would be deposited during these times by other people. I believe that they're opening up their homes in these small groups. I believe you're going to take something with you as well. They're coming together twice a month, and I believe what they are doing in that ministry is also creating home improvements. Home improvements. This may sound random. I don't know if I feel like I'm supposed to say this. I believe things are coming that will shake this country. I believe things are coming that's going to shake this community. And whether we go back and call these things the four pillars, but we need structure. You need structure in your life. We need to be devoted to the things that are important. And in these small groups, I remember getting on Brother Preston, you know, if you don't sign up, there's no pressure. I don't even say this to create any pressure. It's all whosoever we. But I believe by devoting ourselves to coming together and understanding that's an important thing to come, not to be jockeyed and have some reason of not being here. Find reasons of why you should be here. And to come together for teaching and to preaching, to having fellowship.